Did you hear about the California Owl Conspiracy Network?
No.
They're calling them the cahoots.
Some of you know that I've been researching the 1969 Woodstock Festival. When I found out that the festival was funded by Wall Street and that the security chief for Woodstock later became a director for the DEA, I wanted to look a little deeper. Since then, I've read about 5 books and consumed countless hours of direct source interviews in order to compile the history of Woodstock with direct source material. You know, you can't say Woodstock without LSD, and you can't say LSD without Owsley Stanley. In 1956, he enlisted in the United States Air Force as an electronic specialist, serving for 18 months, including stints at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, that's NASA, and Edwards Air Force Base's Rocket Engine Test Facility. The scion of a wealthy political family, Owsley's grandfather was a governor, a senator, and even ran for president of the United States. His father was a U.S. attorney. Owsley was the sound engineer for the Grateful Dead, and the man who supplied most of America's burgeoning hippie scene with LSD. Although under constant FBI surveillance, and having been convicted for manufacturing LSD and serving a 2-year sentence, journalists who requested his FBI files with FOIA requests were shocked to find that they were missing. Now, I've been making some secret videos for my Patreon subscribers about the things I've been finding about Owsley, and I think that's where Martin's ribbing about the Owls conspiracy in California comes in. I mean, hey, I can't help if the trail leads in strange places. But today I encountered a coincidence or a happy accident in my research that confirmed for me that I'm on the right trail. Some of you might remember my interview with Jeremy Reeves. He mentioned a book about the Black Patch Tobacco Wars. I purchased the book for Jeremy and myself, and I know that some of you purchased the book as well. This is the man who wrote the charter for the group that formed the Night Riders of the Black Patch Tobacco Wars. Can you guess his name?
He helped draft the charter for the Dark District Tobacco Planters Association. Some of the more radical members of this group, known as the Night Riders, used vigilante violence to compel membership in the association during what became known as the Black Patch Tobacco Wars.
Einhorn is Finkel. Finkel is Einhorn!
After Bear's death, he became available for a public Freedom of Information Act filing. This must be my mistake, because, this guy did federal time, and, he was arrested by a federal agency and had him under, surveillance
for years.
So, I hired some guy that does this for a living, and he comes back, and he's got this tiny little scrap of information from a DEA file, and you can't understand it. It's not written in English. I'm on the phone to the Department of Justice, and I talk to a FOIA officer. And this guy goes, oh, it must be some mistake, Federal surveillance, FBI arrest, federal penitentiary. I'll be back at you in just a few minutes. He calls back a few days later. He says, I don't understand this. There's no FBI records on this guy.
Now, Joel, didn't you tell me that you had seen Garcia's?
There's tons of those guys. I mean, Country Joe's is hilarious. It's all redacted.
Yeah.
There's like two sentences that you can read, but there's like 22 pages.
So what did this lead you to believe?
Well, who gets their files redacted?
Well, redacted, blacked out is one thing, but
these are gone. These are disappeared, right? You know, and you know, Owsley spoke Russian. He was in the Air Force, and you know, Owsley was Owsley too. I'm sitting here listening to you talk, you know, and it's so interesting. You make him sound like an ordinary human being.
He wasn't. He was not.
There wasn't anybody like him ever.
Not ever.
And. You know, yeah, a spy. I mean, that's the only possible, really, you know, explanation. If you can think of another one, let me know.
Well, I came upon a child of God. He was walking along.
Most of the history from Woodstock that I'm drawing upon will be from Bob Spitz's book about the creation of the Woodstock Festival. In the book, hiring Ken Kesey and the Merry Pranksters was part of the early planning stages of the festival. By the time the festival came around, the Merry Pranksters had fled the hog farm in North Hollywood after Charles Manson showed up and tried to steal Wavy Gravy's women. The group was in New Mexico at the time, and the festival sent an astrojet to bring them to the festival in New York. At one point in the book, a hog farmer mentions that they have a lab set up in Movement City, the tent city they had set up in the forest. While it's doubtful they were making acid in an environment like Woodstock, they were most likely the source of most of the LSD going around that day.
What is the hog farm going to be doing in Woodstock?
Well, the hog farm is a many-sided, we're kind of a family, a huge expanded family. And we could do any number of things, because each one of us is going to do a different thing. But mostly we're just going to try and be groovy and spread that grooviness through everybody.
Well, if you can't describe what you were doing with acid before, can you describe what was different about what the Kesey outfit was doing with it?
Well, it was magic. It took you into a place that was like the descriptions in the books by the Rosicrucians and the Freemasons, and it was the introduction to magic.
We've got to get ourselves back to the dark.
You know, all us people from the Bay Area, we're real LSD freaks. The stuff that they're passing out here today may or may not be LSD, but there's a chance that you won't have a very good trip. Now, what you're supposed to do after you know that is you're supposed to stop taking it.
I am informed that somebody somewhere is giving out some flat blue acid. It is poison. It's deadly serious, man. Be cool.
Those of you who have partaken of the green acid, if you would, as soon as convenient, please go to the hospital tent.
There is someone giving out some flat blue acid. It is poison. There are 15 people who are very ill from it.
That new form of energy, LSD, was discovered by accident in 1948 by Professor Albert Hoffman at the Swiss Sandoz Laboratories.
Now, I was working at a pharmaceutical company that summer at Sandoz, and I was using LSD on rats on Fridays. So we're going to Woodstock, and I'm seeing all these people tripping out, and I'm going, are you kidding me? No way am I gonna try any of that stuff, because I saw what it did to the rats.
Was it on those two?
There were about 120 of us down in Palo Alto, students and unstudents that were the government wanted somebody to look in that room. They said, hey, we got a great room. We discovered this nice room. Let's get somebody to go in there and look it over.
So you went in, 8 months, looked over a room, huh?
Right, walked out. The government said, don't let anybody else in that room.
You know, the interesting thing is that the government may have started the whole LSD experience for all the people that tried that stuff, since they were the ones that set up the experiments to begin with.
Well, yeah, it's on a certain level. Maybe so. Maybe they made it available.
Oh, what are you, recharging there?
Electric. It's German wine. The acid came from Switzerland. Go ahead.
Gradually made its way into the intellectual and artistic communities in major U.S. cities via sympathetic psychologists like Dr. John Beresford.
You can't explain the shift from the 50s mentality to the 60s mentality in any other way but the introduction of LSD into the social scene.
I never believed in LSD, but I understood the power of it. A little bit like witchcraft, maybe.
Sometimes all I think about is you. Late nights in the middle of June. Heat waves been faking me out. Can't make you happier now. Sometimes all I think about is you. Late nights in the middle of June. Heat waves been faking me out. Sometimes all I think about is you. Late nights in the middle of June.